plane. Okay? So I've got alkalosis, down alkalosis, down acidosis. So we're going to say this is partially compensated respiratory alkalosis. Okay? So now what we're going to do is what we know. We know, is it compensation or is this just physiologically what happens with hydrolysis? Okay? So, you know what? This must not have been the right page. So don't look at these facts right here, because this doesn't go with this one. Mm-hmm. For some reason, the problem doesn't match my paper. All right, so if we know for every change in 20, what happens to our pH? So everybody see that my CO2 is going down 20. My pH is going to go up by what? 0.16. Because if it went the other way, if the CO2 went up by 10, pH goes down by 0.08. So let's see if it works. So if I take 7.40 and I am going to add 0.16, we know that the pH matches. So it really isn't partially compensated respiratory alkalosis. What is it? Acute respiratory alkalosis.
How come?
Because now the pH is matching so far. Now we know what happens for every change in bicarb. So the bicarb now is going to do what? It goes down
4
for every change in 20. The pH, the bicarb goes down to 4, which it did. Okay?
Okay, yes.
Good?
Wait, yeah.
Okay.
Okay, so what we have to get in our little heads is we have to know what happens when something changes, okay? So we have to just kind of go home and memorize that when the pH, when the CO2 goes down by 20, the pH and bicarb are going to change, okay? Because remember, you are now measuring all these things. So CO2 goes down by 20, we know that our pH is going to go up 5.16. Because of that, also because of the hydrolysis.
So this is not partially compensated?
No, nope, it's really just acute because it's physiologically what's happening because of hydrolysis. So what's happening is a partially compensated respiratory alkalosis, but the body has just been buffering it because that's what the body buffers. So when it breaks down, that buffering system is there.
So if you call it partially compensated, is it correct or incorrect?
Technically it's correct. But what's really happening is those kidneys really haven't kicked in yet.
Yeah.
It's just what hydrolysis is doing to buffer. So you're really buffering it right now. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So that's what it's called when the hydrolysis kicks in?
Yeah. So it's buffered. This is truly just buffered right now, not compensation. Okay? Does that make sense?
You know how it's like acute, chronic, partially compensated, fully compensated, mixed? But is it also buffering one of those?
So what's happening really is you really do have a partially compensated respiratory alkalosis.
Yeah.
But the kidney part of it is just truly what happens with buffering with hydrolysis. The kidneys really have not reacted yet. They are just buffering.
Yeah.
Now, if this had spin... Now the kidneys have kicked in. Now that's truly a partially compensated respiratory alkalosis because the kidneys really have
It doesn't match.
Right. Well. Because it's buffering because of what's hydrolysis. But now with the 18, the kidneys truly have kicked in and are starting to compensate. Okay, does that make sense?
Yeah.
When you do it out, is it going to be the same or is it going to be different? So this.
What's going to be the same?
So you have, you did the, that is the 7.56, and then are you supposed to do the respiratory?
So what I do is, what I know is two things happen. Mm-hmm. Okay, so the main problem is respiratory. So the respiratory is what's going to change the pH.
Okay.
But the CO2 has a relationship with bicarb. Okay. So what's going to happen is that because this happens, this is the hydrolysis part. There's buffering that's taking place. Because remember, when your pH is off, so what I guess I have to get you to understand is that when you're out of normal, there's buffers and there's compensation. So you can fix that pH by two ways. The body automatically buffers. So when you read in your book, you read about your phosphates and your proteins, there's all those buffers in there because your body can't wait for the kidneys. So there's got to be some other mechanism. So the buffers are there and they react quickly. Okay?
Kind of like the respiratory system, right?
Right.
Okay.
But the kidneys are going to take time. So when we look at this one right here, we see that really the buffering system is kicked in. We've got respiratory alkalosis, compensation is taking place, but it's just buffers that are really, the kidneys themselves haven't kicked into gear because that's normal physiologically what would happen with the buffer system that's in your body. Had I had 18, then I would have known that now compensation truly is taking place and buffering isn't working.
But would that be considered partially or it's fully
still,
compensated?
Nope, fully wouldn't be till this goes back to normal.
Oh, right,
it would
right,
be
right.
Acute.
Oh, gotcha.
This would be still partially. So what it's telling me is that here, that the buffering system is working.
Yeah.
If I had 18, then it really would have been compensation. Does that make sense? It is a partially compensated respiratory alkalosis, but the buffering is taking place, not compensation by the kidneys yet.
So when we see that, respiratory alkalosis, that equation is the one that we should automatically do
yep.
first.
Yep.
And when we see respiratory acidosis, then we do the other equation where CO2 goes up, pH
yep.
goes down. So we just
yep.
have to memorize those numbers.
Yep.
And if you didn't see any buffer at all, you could assume that it's like a brand new
so
issue.
So if I didn't see any buffering going on, so say I saw... Okay, now that's going to alert me that there's something else going on. Now there's more than just a primary respiratory alkalosis going on. Okay, so that's going to show us, and we're going to work our way towards that.
Okay.
But right now, I want you to get the basics. Difference between buffering and compensation. Does everybody think they got that?
No.
Yeah?
No.
Now, what I do want you to do is, I do want you to look at these little boxes here, because these little boxes help you to understand. Now, look at where it says chronic respiratory acidosis. Alrighty? It says the explanation. It says for every chronic increase of 10 by the CO2, the kidneys will respond by increasing bicarb by 4. This will result from the pH from the acute drop of 0.08 below normal to only 0.03 below normal. So what happens is that with chronic conditions now, what happens is it's going to react a little bit different. So your pH changes a little differently because the body is chronically going there. So this is compensation. When only one system responds to counteract the abnormal changes resulting from the other one. It takes the kidneys 1 to 3 days to maximally compensate for changes in the respiratory CO2 levels. So kind of see that. That's a chronic condition. This patient's not going back. Let's look at metabolic acidosis, which is below. It says for every decrease of 1 millimeter, a million equivalent liters of bicarb, the pH will decrease by 0.15 and the CO2 will decrease by 1.2. So there's just your mechanism. So when you have metabolic acidosis, for every drop in bicarb from 24 down, your pH should decrease by 0.015 for everyone that it went, and your CO2 should decrease by 1.2. Everybody see that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Now, with metabolic alkalosis, the explanation tells you, and if you look at the diagram, it's kind of showing you it. And what I will do is is my little book. If you want to see the little book, it's in my bag in my office. If for some reason you can't see the diagram real well, I'll bring my book so you can see it and take pictures if you want. So it says, for every increase in 1 milliequivalent per liter of bicarb, the pH will increase by 0.15. So you can see the pH stays the same, just like it did with the number. Like with CO2, it really was the same, but it's for every 20, it's 0.16. For every 10, it's 0.08, which is the same thing, okay? For every CO2 will increase by 0.7. Note that the CO2 changes can be highly variable. Again, because you're looking at hydrolysis. When the kidneys are responsible for acidosis or alkalemia, the lungs are quick to respond within minutes to compensate by either blowing off or retaining CO2. Remember, think of CO2 as an acid to try to help minimize the metabolic changes. Due to the quickness of the lung to respond, there is never really any functional distinction between acute or chronic metabolic alkalosis because it responds. Remember, the kidneys are slow. The respiratory system is that volatile acid. It responds, okay? Go to your next page. So here is a little diagram to summarize the overview of hydrolysis and compensation. Is that what you like, system? Yes. See? For those of you that like a chart or a system, there it goes for you. So some people like that better than trying to verbalize it. So it kind of puts it there. It shows you the pH and the bicarb. It shows you it right there. Again, for changes in bicarb are due to hydrolysis and not compensation. For the ease of calculation, it tells you for every milliequivalent in bicarb, the last digits of the pH are changing. It just kind of shows you that. Now, all the changes values are approximation. The lung change in response to metabolic conditions are the most variable, and you can see that. When a compensation is appropriate, the expected change isn't seen. This indicates that one or only one primary blood gas disorder is working, and that the compensation is normal because you've got buffering going on. When the compensation is inappropriate or not appropriate, apparent over compensation more than expected, the body doesn't overcompensate. And that's an important thing to remember. Your body isn't going to overcompensate. An apparent overcompensation is actually an indication that another primary blood gas disorder is at work and is in the opposite direction. So for an example, it says to you, a respiratory acidosis and a metabolic alkalosis. The alkalosis appears to overcompensate for the acidosis, but since the body doesn't overcompensate, it is actually not a compensation, but rather than another primary disorder. Okay? So when you go and look, and if you see that metabolic alkalosis is more than what it should calculate out to be, then it's telling you that there's two things going on. The body is in a respiratory acidosis and a metabolic alkalosis. Is it starting to make a little bit of sense? So one thing you've got to get out of in your minds today is your body can't overcompensate. So if that compensation is greater than it should be, then the body has two problems going on at the same time. And what we're going to see is it actually can have three. But the only system that can't have two going on at the same time is the respiratory system, because you either are hyper or hypoventilating. But we're going to see with the kidneys, because they can either gain or lose acids or gain and lose bicarb, it can have two problems going on at the same time. And then the respiratory system can be trying to fix it. So far, so good?
So I didn't understand the part about the body can't over. So when we look at, like, say that one, you said that it went down to 18.
Right.
So that if it was 18, then that would be compensated. So is that what you mean by?
So what
or,
I'm.
Or not uncompensated.
So what I'm trying to say is that by buffering, by hydrolysis, this couldn't happen. The body can't overcompensate. So if I really had 18 here, it would tell me that not only do I have a partially compensated respiratory alkalosis, but I have a metabolic acidosis going on, because that technically couldn't happen.
So it would be mixed.
It would be mixed. So So now something else is going on. The body can't overcompensate. Okay? So now something else is going on. Does that make sense?
So if it's outside that value, then would we call it mixed?
So then what we know is something else is going on. Yep. And that's what we're going to calculate. That's what we're going to look at now. So far, so good? Okay.
I'm going to tell me 1 second ago.
Okay.
No.
All right. Well, let's just...
This whole time we've been learning that if it's outside that value, then it's compensating.
It's compensating. But it can't overcompensate. So you can't over. So if something is over, then it's going to be going on. So maybe in a few minutes it'll make some sense.
Okay.
Let's look at when it overdoes it, okay? But the most important thing I want you to get right now is you can't overcompensate. So if there's something more than it should be, then the body has another problem going on. And what I want you to realize is the respiratory system can only be in one. It can either be normal, acid, or alkalotic, because you can only hypo or hyperventilate. You can't do both, okay? But the kidneys can do a couple of things, because remember, the kidneys have both acid and bicarb. You can either gain or lose. Okay?
So that's
where your stuff comes in. So now think about it. You can be vomiting and have diarrhea at the exact same time.
You can.
Think about what your body's going to do pH-wise. Okay? I thought I had it last night for my own cooking. I said to my husband, "You're sick," but he wasn't, so it was just
what did you make? Just out of curiosity.
I just chicken with shaking bake. I don't know. I just didn't feel good. I think it was because I called in Saturday night and had to work. Then I cleaned my house all day. Yes, I think I just was tired. I don't know, but boy, I woke up at 3 o'clock in the morning ready to go home. I thought it was my own cooking, because it was like, I won't eat that again. That chicken that's in the fridge is going soft.
Did you lose power? And then
no, well, I had my generator, so my refrigerator never did it. I think it was me. I've had food poisoning twice by outside sources, so my stomach is very sensitive to the littlest thing. So once you get food poisoning,
you know what you need to do, what I do, and just eat everything inside and don't care.
I've had food poisoning. So now let's kind of look at some of the things. So now step four, it talked about calculating your anion gap and your bicarb gap. Your anion gap is always abbreviated as AG, your bicarbonate gap is always as BG. And it's very simple. All you're going to do for the anion gap is take the sodium level, which is your extracellular electrolyte, and subtract it from the chloride and the bicarb added together. Okay?
Which paper are we on?
I don't have that.
I'm right here. Step 7 calculation.
Yeah, it says page 52. Is that a book that we have? Or?
I have it in here somewhere. Okay. It's in here. Okay. And then, of course, oxygenation. So, and to calculate the bicarbonate, all you do is take the patient's bicarb and add the change of your anion gap. Okay? So we'll look at the gap. So you're only going to do the bicarbonate gap in certain situations, and we'll see that. So again, always, like it says, look for consistency with your patient baseline. As with any lab tests, we treat the patient, not the number. Serial blood gases are more important than a single one. So as your patient, look at their history, their physical, look at their labs, look at their disease and their drugs and their therapies, and make sure that it all makes sense there, okay? Also note, full compensation back to normal pH in severe disorders where compensation doesn't normally return to normal pH indicates that there's another primary problem going on. So we can see respiratory alkalosis and metabolic alkalosis. And an instant compensation by the kidneys, which does not occur, is usually an actual indication of a mixed and disturbance, because kidneys don't respond quickly like that. So if it's not something that you know that's chronic and you automatically have a pH that's back to normal and that's not making sense, so if I saw that with one of you, then you would know that something else is going on that made that.
So this is where like the electrolyte
like
yes.
all the other normal values come into play that we need to have a sheet.
Absolutely. So always check for accuracies and errors. Again, look at that blood gas lab that slip. Don't report question marks. Don't report the quality control. Just make sure everything is perfect before you set that off. Okay. And then, of course, there's your final interpretation. And as it says, the final interpretation is sometimes quite different from the initial or technical or functional classification. And here's where we come into play, because most people just learn the technical, partially compensated metabolic acidosis. And then they sit there and say, this isn't making sense. Why is the patient not responding? Or why are we not going to put BiPAP on this patient? So when you, as the technical experts, look at this blood gas, then you can say to the physician, yes, this patient has a metabolic alkalosis, but he really had a respiratory acidosis going on, but there's also maybe a metabolic acidosis going on too with this patient. So we're going to look to see that. Here's the technical, but when you look at the final thing of what the body can actually do, this is the real interpretation of the blood gas, okay? So we're going to take it that one extra step, okay? Mm-hmm. So it tells us that the body is unable to compensate due to the lung and kidney compromise. A COPD or with diabetes mellitus is unable to hyperventilate for a metabolic acidosis caused by ketoacidosis. The inability to hyperventilate could be caused by muscle fatigue or mucus plugging. So think about what he's kind of telling you. Here's a COPD who now has diabetes. Now we know diabetes, if we had a metabolic, would be Kussmaul's breathing. Well, picture your COPD, or can he do Kussmaul's breathing?
No.
No, he can't do that. So what's gonna happen is that the inability to hyperventilate could be caused by the muscle fatigue, the mucus plugging. So that patient now, again, is gonna need that insulin. But you have to realize that that patient can't do what they should do for the compensation of that disease. They just physiologically couldn't do it. Just like if you had an ALS patient that all of a sudden becomes a diabetic, could that patient do this Kussmaul breathing? Absolutely not, okay? And efficient time to compensate. Example, the respiratory is usually immediate, 3 to 30 minutes longer for max. The kidneys take 12 to 24 hours from beginning of compensation up to 2 to 3 days for full compensation. So, you know, if you walked in and you had somebody that comes into the emergency room that's been in an automobile accident and is in pain and all this, and all of a sudden you see the kidneys have kicked in, the kidneys can't do that quickly. Mm-hmm. Doesn't make sense. Kidneys can't respond that quickly if it's past the hydrolysis stage. Make sense? And then it says another primary ABG is at work, is in the same direction. Respiratory medical alkalosis, okay. Oh, then we know we can see that. So let's go to our next page. Here's your mixed disorders, okay?
Just going back to that. So if the person was in an automobile accident,
yep.
And you noticed that the kidneys did kick in, are you saying that there's an underlying chronic condition?
No, there's another primary problem going on.
But could it be possibly chronic because it kicked in so quickly? Because you're saying that the kidneys need 12 to 24 hours to kick in.
Right. So that patient, oh, you're saying could they have a chronic condition and didn't know it?
Because the kidneys kicked in.
They could. They could, but patients usually with chronic conditions know that they're sick. You've seen them. Someone usually doesn't have like a chronic condition that doesn't know it. Like if you've got diabetes, you would know it. So when the body is out of whack.
But there has to be a point where you like, what if like before you were diagnosed?
Nope, the body would know. You would know.
Oh, you would know. Okay.
If you're not in normal pH, you would see changes. Like if you've got a respiratory disorder, you just don't go breathing normally, then all of a sudden your body makes changes. So you're gonna see those changes. That's why we do history. Patients don't come in with metabolic problems without having them. They notice over time that their sugar's off or their whatever's off. Does that make sense? The body just normally doesn't go from being normal to being chronic, gradually. That's why serial blood gases are good, because we see where the disease is going. We start to see where it's actually going. So what I did here is this is examples of mixed disorders. And those of you that like charts, it's a chart kind of thing. So you can see when you match respiratory acidosis with metabolic acidosis, you could have somebody that's in acute pulmonary edema. You got cardiac arrest, COPD exacerbation and lactic acid. You got some poisonings, renal failure, and respiratory failure. Metabolic acidosis with respiratory acidosis, alkalosis, I mean, is renal insufficiency. Does everybody get how to read the chart? Mm-hmm. So here's where you've got double problems going on, okay? Where you could see more than, when you look at it, you're going to see two primary problems are going on there. So a patient that's in acute pulmonary edema is going to have metabolic acidosis and respiratory acidosis going on because of their disease state. Is that making sense? Okay. So, and that's what it kind of shows you. Then you go metabolic alkalosis with respiratory acidosis. Here's that COPD that's vomiting, or they're on diuretics. You know, they took too much of their diuretics, and now they have respiratory acidosis and metabolic alkalosis going on. And then here's your metabolic alkalosis with metabolic acidosis, okay? So here's that patient that's going to have two metabolic problems going on. Can it happen? Absolutely. You got renal failure. You got alcohol ketoacidosis, aka or diabetic ketoacidosis, with vomiting, with diuretics, and with they have nasal gastric suctioning. So the metabolic system is just totally off. Okay?
Oh, Martha, I have a question. Suctioning, gastric suctioning, and gastric.
NG drainage.
Are they the same thing?
Yeah.
Okay.
You're just taking acid out of the stomach.
Okay.
So now let's go to the next one. It kind of shows you, again, for your little graphs, it gives you what respiratory acidosis is. And at this point, we all know that it's increase in CO2. You've got hypercapnia caused by hypoventilation. And it kind of shows you if it's acute, what's going to happen, if it's partially compensated, and if it's fully compensated. And again, an acute change from normal is due to the hydrolysis effect rather than compensation itself. So if we did it out and we saw that for every change in 10, the pH went down by 0.08, then we know that it's hydrolysis that's changed and our bicarb has changed only because of hydrolysis. But if it's anything after that, then we know that compensation is in there. Okay? Rare. Maximum renal compensation commonly results in only partial compensation of pH. pH only returns less than halfway unless there's a very mild respiratory acidosis, and we'll talk about that. So here's talking about your compensation, where you expect the pH to be and what happens with the bicarb. And then it gives you it if you wanted to calculate it out in a formula.
Is that what you were showing us earlier?
Yep. Yep, and that's what you can kind of see there. And they give you a little reference chart where you expect to see it. Okay. Then on the next page, it kind of goes through what your signs and symptoms of acute respiratory acidosis are. And at this point, you guys all should know these. We've been dealing with them. You know, make sure you know those. And again, here's some of the symptoms that you see with chronic respiratory acidosis. The cardiopulmonary system versus the central nervous system versus the renal and metabolic system. And these are what you start to see with your COPDs, and you should look at these and know them. Then it gives you the causes of respiratory acidosis, what causes it. And again, just kind of think of anything that causes your patient to hypoventilate. And then, of course, how do we manage respiratory acidosis? We know that the problem is hypoventilation. The CO2 is up in the bicarb, the pH is down. So your goal is to improve ventilation and get your pH and your CO2 back to normal unless they're chronic. Treat the primary ABG disorder. Secondary changes, compensations will usually correct themselves after the primary disorder is corrected. So normalize, should always aim for the patient's normal baseline. Don't go over. So if you've got a CO2er, a COPDer, go for what's normal for them. Never overshoot, okay? So correct, obviously we want to correct what's causing the hypoventilation. Is it a pneumonia? Is it a drug overdose? What is it? Your whole goal is to correct that, okay? If you can't, then we'll see what's going to happen. But here, we could correct it with aerosol humidity, airway management, bronchial hygiene, which we're going to get to, bronchodilators, lung expansion therapy, oxygen therapy. We might have to give some steroids. We might try non-invasive. If non-invasive doesn't work, then we're going to intubate and ventilate. Okay? And then we'll look at that. Okay. So then, of course, here is just acute respiratory failure, impending respiratory failure. We prophylactically put them on the ventilator, or sometimes we hyperventilate them, and we're going to cause some permissive hypercapnia to take place. So I'm going to stop here. So you can kind of see how these notes, what it's going to do is go through and talk about all the things that can happen. I'm not going to go over this because I think it's pretty self-explanatory. I mean, it's not a blood gas. You've got a venous blood gas.
Can you hold it up again?
This one, he had the pit falls.
Okay.
This is just going over all the things that you could go wrong, and it gives you a very good explanation. I'm not going to...